What I want to do today is to talk about the idea of weaponizing refugees. Now, in the early March this year, General Philip Seymour, who was the Supreme Allied Commander of the NATO and a senior United States General, argued in testimony to the United States that the Syrian and the government would engage in the weaponization of refugees from Syria. Now, by this, Breedlove like meant that what was happening was receiving use of indiscriminate targeting policies, including use of systems such as barrel bombs. The Russian and Syrian governments were deliberately trying to uproot Syrian civilians and push them out of Syria and into Turkey, which is a NATO member, of course, and from there onwards into Europe. Now, the purpose of this Breedlove objective to the US summit was to try to destabilize a crucial NATO member state, destabilize the alliance itself, and to do this in a context of rising tensions between NATO and Russia, not just over the future of Syria, but also in the relationship to Ukraine, and generally increasing Russian assertiveness in the state. Now, the scale of the Syrian refugee crisis is worth recalling because it is truly exceptional. The most recent United Nations High Commission for Refugees figures suggest that there are now 4.8 million Syrians displaced outside of Syria. Other estimates of the number of people internally displaced is standard about 7.5 million. Of those, then 2.7 million of refugees are in Turkey, about 1 million in Lebanon, something like 650,000 in Jordan, and about 1 million have made asylum applications. That means that there are probably about 3.5 million Syrian refugees in the territory of NATO member states. Those within Europe have typically distributed themselves along the following lines. About 62% have sought asylum in Germany, Kosovo, and Serbia, the overwhelming majority in Germany, which is a NATO member. About another 27% are in Sweden, Austria, Denmark, and the Netherlands, and the last two of those are also. Now, what Breedlove seeks to do with his point is to draw attention to some fairly basic claims. Now, one claim that I don't really want to engage with here is the idea of whether or not Breedlove protects the Russian Syrian government policies as it were in Turkey too, whether this is actually what's happening with the liberal creation of the government systems. He's neither here nor there, I think, with the right of the government. What's striking about Breedlove's comments instead is that they potentially point to some really quite fundamental challenges to some very basic ideas we have about the position of civilians in warfare, and in particular those who find themselves displaced by such a conflict. Typically, we tend to assume such people are accidental or unintended victims of war, that the creation of refugee flows is part of the general fallout of armed conflict between groups seeking to control territory. Clearly, Breedlove's argument that there's nothing accidental can be found with the fall of this case. And that, I want to suggest, challenges two really fundamental ideas we have about the position of civilians in this conflict. On the one hand, it raises some basic questions about what kinds of protections can be put in place for civilians. And on the other hand, it raises some questions about what obligations do we owe as we see the threats in the face of such refugees. Okay, so to turn to the first of those in the idea of civilian protection. Now, the most familiar and arguably the most influential way of thinking about the ethical duties that are owed to civilians in war comes within a very old tradition of thought known as just war theory. Now, just war theory is very influential. It underpins, for example, a big deal of international humanitarian war in this area. And one of the things that this element of just war theory tries to do is to make an argument that civilians shouldn't be tied up, shouldn't get engaged in warfare, because essentially there aren't any good enough reasons to want to be warfare. It normally does this by reference to two specific principles. The first of these is the idea of discrimination. Now, this, on the one hand, is a really simple idea. But within the context of a war, there are two groups of people. We have a group that we know as combatants, and we may legitimately and deliberately target combatants with military tools. the other is everybody else. That's a group of people who use the labour to make them back into civilians. And there are no reasons why we should deliberately target civilians with military tools. Now, drawing a line between those two groups is always difficult. It's always been contested and it's always controversial. And it's particularly so in the context of conflicts such as that in Syria, where we have a large number of non-state groups of conflicts. Irrespective of where you draw the line, what is consistent though is this idea that those who make up the civilian population should not find themselves involved in war, so they should not be deliberately targeted for military tools, because essentially there is no good reason to deploy this to come. We shouldn't put their lives and their property in danger, because doing so cannot make an effective military contribution. Okay, so that's the first of these arguments. It creates a notion of non-combatants and political strategy. The second of these ideas is to force an analogy. Now, this too is a pretty simple idea. It's the claim that the level of military force that is used should be proportionate to the anticipated military objectives. So, for example, that familiar aphorism here would be that one shouldn't use stress tactics. The policies of overkill and misery. Now, proportionality brings with it a crucial calculation. And this is the extent to which certain kinds of tactics or weapon systems may bring about the foreseeable, if unintended, death or injury to civilians. Proportionality allows for the possibility that it may be more impossible to carry out military operations to kill the civilians to destroy their property if the military response to the rise of specific civilians. Now, both of these ideas typically relate to the moment of the application of military force. We are dealing here with the moment at which people find themselves being shot at, bombed, or shot. The notion of Syria, the notion of weaponized refugees, starts to bring with, of course, the thought about this idea of the moment of the engagement has been participating to the point. So, for Syria, the military significance that he is suggesting of Syrian refugees did not arise at the moment of engagement. Russian and Syrian government agents are not attacking these civilians because it will help them bring about victory over those elements in Syria who want to get rid of the Syrian government. The real military significance of this conflict actually only arises when these people cross the surface border and potentially move on into Europe. So that challenges this idea that the moment of engagement. The second point which raises, which is core to this idea that the moment of engagement is is that, of course, a lot of refugees have not actually suffered dark bottoms of terrorist force. The reason why refugees flee is not just because they have actually been shot at, or shot, or bombed. Many refugees flee their homes and their homeland because they are afraid that this is happening at some point in the future. So, this suggests how the notion of weaponized refugees threats the ability to cause the kind of basic messages to us to think about protection. Now, what I want to do next then is to think about the second of these kinds of fundamental challenges. And that's to highlight the notion of the obligations of these kinds of states. We have, as we've seen, an extraordinarily large number of Syrian citizens pushed out of their country. What do they do? Recall those million asylum applications within now, Syrians are entitled to apply for and to receive asylum on the basis that they are fleeing a well-founded fear of persecution. That's the word we find in the 1951 Convention that provides the basis for international war in Syria. Now, lots of people have come to agree that the idea of persecution should extend to cover those who are fleeing a well-founded fear of death or injury as a result of an conflict. And there are a number of international legal statutes that incorporate that. What this points to is the idea that Syrian refugees, as all refugees, are in some sense innocent. That they have done something that they have been forced out of to, not of anything that they have necessarily done that is wrong, they are innocent they are also innocent because they typically regard the violence that has been inflicted against them or the threat that has been inflicted against them as a safe and threat. Now, for lots of people, the consequences for this are pretty straightforward. Those who receive refugees have an overwhelming moral obligation to provide them with sanctuary. We provide refugees with sanctuary, we grant them asylum, the whole world of liberty. But because we recognize the injustice of the violence that has been done to them, we accept their innocence. These people are innocent and false of their own. They don't deserve innocence. And we also typically want to invoke a notion of some kind of collective management. But by forgiving people sanctuary, by granting them asylum, we uphold a principle that we too would hope to the boot of the boot and the foot, and that we would benefit from. So the provision of sanctuary reflects an idea about shared humanity. Now, there are lots of reasons why people want to object to hosting large numbers of Syrian refugees. I'll deal with them briefly, but I think that they have much nothing to do with So, for example, we get some familiar objections. Let me see if I can put this one. So, how about this one? The country is full. We can't afford it. Time of economic hardship in our own country, we simply can't bear the cost of hosting refugees in our second country. The Prime Minister's statement seems to be, if we accept these refugees, then we simply encourage even more to come. Others would suggest perhaps that, well, what about the ability of these people to fit into our society? There are big cultural and religious differences, for example, can they assimilate? Some people might be harassed at the time, and for instance, there might be security concerns. Amongst these Syrian refugees, there may be terrorists, or there may be serious killings. Given the practical impossibilities effectively screening such a large number of people, allowing any of them into our country to face the So those kinds of objections have all been raised, but they are not, it seems to me, connected to the idea that we've isolated, that we've refugees. Brings us back, it seems to be, pushes this argument much, much further. So, for Brindler, the security challenge that is presented by Syrian refugees is nothing to do with any of those incidents. It passes no judgment upon the merits of an individual's sanctuary. It passes no judgment upon their willingness to work, their ability to assimilate, or their task to support them. Instead, what it focuses upon is a collective symptom. The idea of weaponized refugees that we'd like to put forward collectivizes the security threat. The security threat that is faced by NATO member states in place is as a result of the phenomenon of Syrian refugees. Nothing to do with each individual person. As a proof, therefore, Syrian refugees are not, in the eyes of the scene, innocent victims of war. Even if they might be, as individuals, instead, as a group, they are a security threat to NATO and to member states. Why, therefore, do we owe them an obligation of asylum? Why should we welcome into our own state something that destabilizes our security and weakens our ability to assist us in securing our security objectives? So, the implications of accepting the category of weaponized refugees I want to suggest are potentially pretty fundamental. What Brindler's argument does is push against what has been the dominant trend in thinking about just war and thinking about the ethics of refugees of at least the last 50 years and really probably going back to the end of the Second World War. Within both of those arenas, the emphasis has very much been upon trying to bring the thinking around that specific system. To recognize that civilians need protection from warfare because they hold certain kinds of individual rights, for instance. That asylum seekers, those fleeing that way of saying that Syrian persecution are individuals who deserve protection and sanctuary. The notion of weaponized refugees instead homogenized the system. It pushes back against that dominant trend of ethical systems of accepting the system. For Greenblatt, it seems, we are not dealing with innocent victims. Instead, what we are dealing with are the dehumanized, homogenized, instrumentalized tools of toxic society. That is a big and bold argument to make. It is one that depends on fundamental implications for how we think about the centrality of individual human beings in the modern world. For Europe to accept that argument, and indeed for any part of the world to accept this as the basis of policy for the place, which are Syrian refugees raised on the Texas refugees raised on the Texas refugees, is to take a step on a path that is diametrically at odds with that common sense of identity. Taken to its logical conclusions, it fundamentally calls into question the very idea that the moral and